Hi, everyone. First off, let me say, and I'm not sure I can say this with enough dramatic effect, wow, what a panel. It was surely an inspired decision of Dr. Nagore Sedano Naveira to put these three papers together. It's indeed a pleasure to stand in for her. My paper is titled An Intergenerational Cartography of a Revolution. In three Iberian graphic novels, the three novels that it refers to were written by Antonia Santolaya, Ana Peñas, and Raquel Rivarossi. We will also keep in mind the work of two more artists, Maliki Cuatro Ojos and Maitena, while taking a prismatic view of the intergenerational cartography. We know from our primary school classes that a prism splits apparently colorless light to reveal its component colors. It has five faces, nine edges, six vertices, and so on. By analogy, we may say that the five faces of Maitena, Santolaya, Maliki Cuatro Ojos, Peñas, and Rivarossi may be seen to glide along the edges of the ventral axis of motherhood, the dorsal axis of daughterhood, the lateral axis of sisterhood, the female libido, the female ego, the female body, ideology, experientiality, and memory. Enabling a view not from just six, but numerous vertices that include an assassin's hideout in Rome, a tiny apartment in Alcorcón, a town on the outskirts of Madrid, the Bolivian Altiplano, a village bar in Las Navas del Marqués in the province of Ávila, and numerous other places on the map. A prismatic view would show up the diverse aspects of what Juliet Mitchell had called the woman's condition, delimited by the contours of inherited and imposed self-perceptions. Inherited from the previous generations of women and imposed by the demands of patriarchal social arrangements. In today's analysis, I will glide along two prismatic edges to cast a look at the political cartography of personal relationships made visible from that viewpoint. The first is the lateral axis of sisterhood. One can speak of three instances of contrasting sisterhood in Ana Peña's novel. The first, shown in the top right panel, is a confrontational relationship between the newly married Maruca and her husband's spinster sister who lives with them, Concha. After months of being sidelined by Concha, who refuses to include Maruca in household decisions, the young girl declares in front of the maid that la señora de la casa soy yo. The second instance comes up when we see Maruca in a flower painting workshop. This is the bottom right panel. She learns to paint and, along with a friend who also attended the workshop, musters the courage to sell her work to an art gallery, which also gives her repeated orders. The third instance of sisterhood depicted in the novel shows two women as abuelas. In her older years, Maruca shares a warm relationship with Herminia, the other abuela protagonist of the novel. We see this in the last panel on the bottom left, where the two women are talking on the phone. Maruca feels bitter and sad, believing that her family does not appreciate the sacrifices she made for them. On the other hand, Herminia, whose children also hardly take the time out to visit her, is stoic about her solitude. As Maruca moves from the village to the city center in Madrid, al lado de la Puerta de Toledo, she tells us, her confidence grows. In Madrid, she fails her driving test three or four times, but gets a license eventually. Her freedom and mobility are correlational. Her subsequent move to the outskirts, combined with old age, makes her feel disconnected and lonely. Showing cartographic consciousness, Peñas marks her abuela's village home with three symbols of authority that she must challenge. Firstly, and we see this in the top right frame, the living room of the house is dominated by a photograph of her husband's graduating medical class, which does not include a single woman. A symbol of superior male and scientific knowledge. Next to the photograph is the cross, a symbol of the religious mandate that consigns women to subservient positions in society. The third is the supercilious Doña Concha, who is drawn dressed in a red jacket in a commanding standing posture. In contrast, Maruja sits shrunken behind her. Doña Concha represents the female embodiment of patriarchy that collaborates with masculine authority to oppress women. The change in Maruja's stature is signaled by Alejandra, the maid. When she answers, "Sí, Doña Concha," in response to Concha's instructions, her eyes are closed and her head is bent in a gesture of unmindful compliance. But when she answers, "Sí, Doña Maruja," she raises her head and opens her eyes as if to take note of Maruja's self-empowerment. Moving clockwise, we see an egalitarian seating arrangement of all the women in the flower painting workshop. Bottles of wine, food on the plates, conveys the festive mood of the occasion. The paintings on the wall feature flowers that are taking on deep red hues over their black and white line sketches, as if reflecting Maruja's acquisition of energy and life of the color red. In the last panel, Peñas blanks out the space entirely to convey multiple affects. Maruja's sense of having made futile sacrifices is writ on the walls, from which all has been erased. The other abuela, Herminia, also faces the same blankness, but she deals with it with greater fortitude. We will not go into the reasons that have shaped the two women's different worldviews, but we'll keep in mind that both are dealing with similar emptiness. When mapping the lateral axis in Santolaya's book, we have to heed Deleuze's caution. He warns us that when we don't have an understanding of cartography, we make ready-made tracings. The trap lies in the ready-made tracing of Antigone that underlies the opening frames of the novel, where Valeria Stoppa, the protagonist, is shown looking for her brother Giorgio. She is lost in the oneric space of the Bolivian altiplano. Giorgio was a protective elder brother and her ideological mentor. He leaves home forever due to an exceptionally acrimonious disagreement with his father. After leaving home, Giorgio becomes a political fugitive. He lives in hiding and dies of cancer before he becomes old. Like Antigone, Valeria loses her brother in a civil war and mounts a challenge against the sovereign. Antigone had defied the new king, Creon's order to leave the body of the defeated Polynices, her brother, unburied outside the city walls. Valeria challenges the sovereign by becoming a militant political dissident. In the graphic novel, the Antigone trope is emphasized through Valeria's work as a nurse in the senior residence facility when she is in her 50s. Antigone accompanies her blind father, Oedipus, when he is exiled from Thebes. She cares for the blind, delirious, amnesiac Oedipus like her child. Similarly, Valeria compassionately takes care of senior citizens in the institutional facility, many of whom suffer from Alzheimer's. Here is where the symbol spills out of the stencil. The ready-made tracing of Antigone, a woman who draws her strength from self-denial and mourning, is not adequate for understanding Valeria's sorrow and discontent. Valeria reciprocates the violence to which she has been subjected. She kills a prominent banker to make a political statement. She also outsmarts the government and does not get caught for the murder. Though Valeria, Santolaya, and Hernandez allow us to visualize, through Valeria, Santolaya, and Hernandez allow us to visualize not only a strong but also powerful Antigone. This paper points out that the earlier historietisas did not take significant note of the importance of the lateral axis. As we see in Maitena's Amigas panel, women friends offer caring companionship, solidarity in difficult times, and good counsel at difficult crossroads to one another. However, they also ignore each other. If one of them finds a boyfriend, are annoyed if the friend buys the same dress, and jealous if the friend wants to share the incredible thing that has happened to her. Maitena is incisively perceptive about various sources of women's insecurities, such as body image issues, pressures of balancing career and home and unsympathetic, indifferent partners. Yet her metropole characters living in Buenos Aires do not seem particularly affected by other women around them. Maliki Cuatro Ojos also does not highlight the role of friendships, especially with other women. A possible reason for this backgrounding of friendships may be seen in one of her panels, where Maliki, hanging out with her friends, says, "Las malas relaciones son las mejores historias para convertirlas en cómics." By corollary, Maliki seems to be ruminating that one does not convert good relationships into comics. The more recent work's emphasis on the lateral axis of siblings and friendships politicizes an area of personal experience that had faded in the rendering of the earlier artists. Santolaya and Peñas, in their new generation works, demand space for the lateral axis, where they can share their experience, where their protagonists can share their experience with friends and siblings their own age without being dependent solely on children and grandchildren for companionship or parents and elders for guidance. In the next section of the presentation, I move on to daughterhood, which I refer to as the dorsal generational axis. In tracing the female dorsal axis, there is little risk of ready-made tracings. In mythology, we do not have any examples of a daughter's excessive devotion towards her mother. At least none came to my mind. It has taken 5,000 years of progressive feminization of the cultural imaginary to create this space for a daughter's homage to her mother. The remembrance of mothers by daughters is the hitherto personal and private that is made political through Raquel Ribarrosi's Que Pachamama and Peña's Estamos Todas Bien. In an interview, Peña said that she found a reason to write Estamos when she posed a question to herself about her grandmothers, asking, "What of theirs is in me? What of theirs is there in the society?" She wanted to highlight the contribution of las mujeres que lavan platos, trabajan y cuidan de los suyos. Peñas's portraits of the mothers of her parents never lose the tender touch, as if their memory is a fragile heirloom that deserves fastidious safekeeping. She sketches every crease in Maruja's face. She uses as many as 10 sketches of Maruja's chair to show the slowness of her life. Herminia, the more spirited abuela, also deserves close attention. She is shown reliving beautiful moments from her past to counter her children's emotional neglect of her. Usually her 5 children are too busy to visit, and when they do, they are too caught up in their own problems to take any notice of hers. As a child, Herminia had been abandoned by her mother, who had left her husband and children for the man she fell in love with. Still, Herminia grew up in a culturally rich atmosphere, never resenting the absent mother. Herminia's grandfather set up a theater adjacent to their house in the village. The theater and the home were extensions of each other. Musical and other cultural performances were a significant part of Herminia's growing up. Peñas draws a set of panels that show the lasting happy memory of those moments. The close-up of Herminia's swaying hips in the last frame contrasts with Maruja's stiff joints. But both images are empathetic cartographies, that is, space-time montages of the journeys that these women have made from villages in Franco's era to tiny apartments in neoliberal regimes. Moving to the dorsal axis in Raquel Ribarrosi's Que Pachamama involved a sharp swerve along a hairpin bend. Where Peñas's mothers are kind and self-sacrificing, Ribarrosi's is unsentimental, cynical, and sarcastic. And Lola Vendetta, the literary persona, loves her for it. Ribarrosi draws some panels that inform the reader that her mother had suffered childhood sexual abuse. I see this opening up of extremely private spaces at the core of Ribarrosi's politics. She rejects the notion of the mother as a pure with a capital P and motherhood as an antidote for demons of the past. Ribarrosi has named her politics re-evolution, which she explains as a second evolution in which the use of various feminist devices needs rethinking. Some of the devices she mentions are, I quote, echar la vista atrás y pensar en lo que has visto en la familia. ¿Qué comentarios, qué opiniones sobre qué ideas se fundamenta tu idea de mujer cisgénero, de mujer transgénero, de mujer heterosexual, de mujer homosexual? Ver cómo te posicionas tú en el mundo con la identidad que tienes. End of quote. In the same interview, she tells us that her mother was her first feminist influence. Riva Rossi articulates her idea of feminism as responder con habilidad. She says that taking responsibility is key to her feminism, in which women must learn new modes of thinking about their position in the workplace, in the domestic space, in romantic relationships, and above all, their relationship with their bodies. In the prologue to Que Pachamama, she thanks her mother for cada minuto que nos ha dedicado. Y por supuesto, te agradezco en mayor medida todos los minutos que te dedicas a ti. She's grateful to her mother for giving herself time to pursue her own interests. As a daughter, she finds material for her art in her mother's grievances and acerbic remarks. Her empathy for her mother makes them a team. Interestingly, both Ana in Estamos Todas Bien and Lola Vendetta, Riva Rossi's literary persona, are mimicking the mothers. Ana imitates the abuela's caring attitude and Lola Vendetta, her mother's rebellious spirit. Riva Rossi emphasizes the transgenerational mimicking by dressing both mother and daughter in stripes. Though the daughter's stripes run perpendicular to the mother's, both women wear dark glasses but of different shapes. Thus, this intergenerational imitation is not identity. Peñas follows a similar technique. Ana wears solid red when she is with Abuela Maruca and orange patterns with Abuela Herminia. The white on gray polka dots of Abuela's sofa turn to red on white spots on Ana's socks. In Abuela Maruca's living room, we see Ana seated below the paintings made by Maruca. And in Abuela Herminia's kitchen, we see her beside a cluttered sink, a clutter made by Herminia, who has never been particular about housework. In the context of intergenerational mimicking, it is helpful to recall J. Mark Baldwin's ideas about sociological imitation. In his 1895 book, he wrote, "Society grows by imitative generalization of the thoughts of individuals." Peñas's and Riva Rossi's politics is a politics of empathy. Through imitation, they establish solidarity with generations of women whose challenges and the capabilities to confront those challenges were very different. Through their literary personas, these artists appear to be setting up a hope for a meaningful intersectional understanding of women around us. These 21st century artists draw out the frustrations and disappointments of their mothers, grandmothers, and great-grandmothers in a way that negates nostalgic remembrance, making it instead a remembrance of a vibrant lived experience. As an example of the dorsal axis from earlier works, we may look at one of Maitena's panels. Here the daughter is shown making derisive remarks to her mother, about her mother. She says that women of her mother's generation were like dolls. No opinaban, no trabajaban, no tenían responsabilidades. The mother in Maitena's panel agrees with the daughter, nostalgically describing her life as paradise. However, the mothers in Ana Peñas's and Riva Rossi's novels discussed here show the falsity of the doll-like image of the previous generation. Another iteration of the mimicry analysis would show up the mimicry even in Maitena's panel, despite the overt lack of empathy between the two generations. On one hand, the dialogue sets the women's worldviews in conflict. On the other, their similarly hunched postures give away their relatively unchanged positions under patriarchal impositions. Let me conclude by emphasizing the sustained connection with second wave feminism in the works of earlier and more recent feminist historietistas. Riva Rossi's imageless panel that states, No tórax tenemos útero, pero tórax hemos vivido en uno. Strongly echoes Adrienne Rich's observation from her 1976 work of Woman Born, where she says, all human life on the planet is born of woman. The one unifying, incontrovertible experience shared by all women and men is that months-long period we spend unfolding inside a woman's body. Ana Peñas's gentle rendering of her grandmother's spirited survival resonates with Carol Hanisch's observation about the women's therapy and personal groups where women gathered in the 1960s to discuss seemingly apolitical questions. Explaining her involvement in these groups, Hanisch wrote in 1969, the reason I participate in these meetings is not to solve any personal problem. One of the first